Good morning. Good morning. A wonderful Tuesday. Another morning that the Lord has given us. And we are grateful because of God including us in the masses of this new day. Every day comes with its blessings. Every day is an opportunity that God brings to us and is able to cause it in our lives that we may be able to pursue him and be able to seek his kingdom. You know what the Bible says, and Jesus gave the formula of this life, that seek ye first the kingdom of God and all its righteousness, and all these others will be added unto you. All these other things will be added unto us when we seek the face of God. And this month we have declared ourselves that we need to want to consecrate ourselves to seek the kingdom of God, to seek his righteousness, to seek his will, to seek his purposes, so that we may be able to align with his will and he may be able to add all these other things unto us. We remember the wisdom of Solomon when he was asked by God, what do you need? And he was able to pursue the purpose of God because God called him and chose him to be a king. And he said, what I need is wisdom on how to carry on my governorship and how I need to carry on taking care of the people you have committed to me. And God was excited because he followed and he was able to connect with his purpose and the purpose that the Lord has appointed him. And you know what God said? Because you have not asked riches and asked all these other things, I will be able to give you wisdom which you have asked to fulfill your purpose, but I will also add other things that you have not asked. And we know that if there was a king that was prenderous, a king that was wealthy, a king that was a king that full of every majesty, Solomon was the king. And you know what? That is the wisdom of pursuing God and his purposes. He is able to fulfill and also meet all our needs because he is our God. Now, brethren, this morning, by God's grace, I want us also to follow up on the week's agenda and the week, what we are doing on this week on repentance. Yesterday, we talked about the grace that we have in God, the grace open to us that when we repent of our sins, God is always willing to forgive our sins. Now, brethren, this morning and this day, we want to be able to pick ourselves that we may be able to do personal repentance. Do you know why should we do personal repentance? Now, brethren, I want to remind us that in the book of James, in the book of James and chapter 5 and verse 16, James encourages the church that confess your sins to one another. Confess your sins to one another that you may be healed. That you may be healed. Because when we confess our sins to one another, what happens? God is able to forgive our sins. When our sins are forgiven, we find healing. When James is talking about healing, he does not only speak about physical healing that comes to our mind very fast. He speaks about our minds, our emotions. Do you know what I've learned? It is not possible to have communion with God when you are hurt. When your emotions are hurt. When you have a wound in your spirit. Sometimes that's why you see even people go before God and they want to pray. Instead of praying, they keep crying in bitterness and in pain before God. And you know the devil knows it. For us to throw our fist in the air and never be specific on what we are looking for, on pursuing the will and the purposes of God, he will always make sure that we are prepared a time to seek and pursue the will of God. But what he does, every time when we go to pray, we start remembering the things that we are going through, the things that have been done to us, the rejection that we have suffered, the every manner of unfaithfulness that have been done to us, the way we have been cheated in our lives, the way we have been taken round and round by people we love, the way people whom we trust, they broke their trust to us. And sometimes you realize that men, instead of seeking and pursuing the issues of God, we start massaging in prayer our wounds. And you know what we do? Not even healing them, but we massage them. We massage them. We massage our pains. We massage our wounds. And then we are not even finding a solution. And therefore, the devil takes away a lot of our time for no reason. That's why James is saying, one of the things that we need to do, confession is what brings healing. And one of the things that we need to do on personal repentance is first to deal with ourselves. Now, that's why we say when we start confessing, before we confess the sin of our families, because we confess the sins of the nation and the sins of the church and do declaration, it is good first to put our house in order. And this is how we put our house in order. One of the things that we need to remember, because when we are standing before God with wounds and bitterness, our prayers are not effective. And that's why James ending that verse, he's saying, and you, when you repent of your sins and when you confess with one another, the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And you know what the enemy always would want? Is like we have prayers but are not effective. That's why he guards us. Either we conceal our sins or we are in wounds and pains. And not only that, we are in unforgiveness. We have not been able to forgive others. And you know the standard was kept in the Lord's Prayer that if we don't forgive other people their sins, then our sins will not be forgiven. And therefore, allow me to take you step by step of the things that we need to deal with, even when we deal with personal repentance. Number one, I want to remind us that in the book of Psalms, Chapter 32, verses 1 and 5. This is what the psalm is. And this is the psalm of David, you remember. He says, "Oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sins is put out to sight. Yes, what joy for those who record the Lord has cleared of guilt, whose lives are lived in a complete honesty. When I refused to confess my sin, my body wasted away, and I groaned all day long. Day and night, your hands of discipline was heavy on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat." Then verses 5, it says, "Finally, I confessed all my sins to you and I stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord, and you forgave me and all my guilt is gone." Hallelujah. You know, brethren, one of the important things that we need to do when we stand before God is first to accept. You see, David is recounting how he tried to argue with God to conceal his sin. And I know the story, you know. And when he sinned, he tried to look on ways on how he's going to hide, how he's going to cover the sin. But he realized later that it was becoming even more heavier on him. He became wasted away. And that's how we are wasted by our sins. That's how we are wasted by bitterness. That's how we are wasted by unforgiveness. That's why we are wasted by immorality. That's how we are wasted by a lying tongue. That's why we are wasted by every manner of sin that I may mention. And because we know ourselves, that is how we are wasted when we become unfaithful. That's how we are wasted when we are people and men who are disobedient, not only to God, but even to people, even in authority, even to people that are our parents, or even to people who are even the people that we are serving. That's how we become when we become rebellious. And we rebel to authority. We rebel to people who want to show us direction. We rebel to the Spirit of God who always guide and tell us this is the way, follow on it. When we rebel from the voice of the Holy Spirit, that is how we become. We become wasted away. David says that we continue groaning all day in verses 3. He also even says something that is amazing, that the hand of God discipline continue to be upon. And you know what? When the discipline of God is upon us, when God is punishing us, by the way, it is good to contend with men, but not with God. You know, men, you can be able to tease them. Even we see even people who are able to con even men. There are even people who can be able to swindle men and be able to run away from punishment or even from consequences. But you know, we cannot. And that's what happened in this country. People are got in grand corruption. But the way they are able to swive away and they run away from it, we cannot even tell. But I want to tell you can never run away from God. And that's why we are supposed to repent. And therefore, step number one is accepting our sins. We accept our sins. And that's why the Bible reminds us that David groans and says, when he tried to dodge God, he never learned away from the heaviness of his discipline. Or even his life continued to be moody and groaning all day long. But when he confessed, God was able to help him. Allow me also to read a very important verse in the book of Proverbs. And in the book of Proverbs, chapter 28 and verses 13, Proverbs chapter 28, and verses 13, this is what the Bible says. The Bible says, and this is the wisdom now of Solomon. Solomon says that people who conceal their sins will not prosper. But if they confess and turn from them, they will receive mercy. You know, one of the most important things that we need to remember, we can never prosper if we continue concealing and hiding our sins. It is difficult because the devil makes it difficult, but it's very simple. When we accept the grace of God, when we repent and confess of our sins, what happens? God is able to move us to the next level. Now, step number two, it is to confess. You know, when we accept that we have sinned, now we confess. And that's what the proverb is saying, that now we conceal. Because the opposite of concealing is when we accept to confess and conceal. In other words, we are able to make it open. Now, if I would read that verse from backwards, it will be saying that if the person who confesses his sin, will prosper, And he who confesses his sin will be able to receive mercy. Brethren, it is important to learn, after we have accepted we have sinned, the step number two, today I would want us that we take time to confess the sins. Now, when we are confessing the sin, you know the word conceal means, sometimes even there are people who go before God and they are still willing to conceal. You are not even specific. You just want to tell God, God, you know I come that you forgive me the sins of omission and commission. You know, it is the human wisdom to try and conceal. Have you ever heard people say, yenyewe kuna mahali naona nilikosea, munisame? You know, you have not, what have you said? You know, that is what the intelligence of men has taught us. But this intelligence of men is defeated by the wisdom of God. If we confess, we must confess. And our God is not a joke. If you sin, you must accept the sin that you have committed. And by then, you know what? We don't need to be ashamed before God. Because even when we have not said it, he knows it. Because he is the one who knows what man doesn't know. Even the people around you, they may not know it. They may not even know the kind of a life you have lived in sin. But you know, if you stand before God who knows everything, the Bible says, and it has taught us that God is omniscient. He is all-knowing. It is good to confess. That is step number two. Step number three, it's also good that very fast, because I have some few minutes there, very fast, let me also read a verse in the book of Leviticus chapter 5. You realize how God was very keen, even in the Old Testament, about people repenting of their sins. And this is what, after he had said all the things that men were doing, and he had talked about several sins, amazingly, and he talked so many things, but he also says this, that when you become aware of your guilt in any of these things, you must confess your sin. In other words, it was not about wholesomeness or general repentance. It was about when you realize that what you didn't do, you come before God and say, you know what? I became disobedient. You know what? I sinned. You know what? I committed a sexual sin. You know what? I stole from people even who do not know. You know what? I told and spoke a lie. You know what? I deceived those people. You know what? Those are the things I corrupted. Those are the things that the Lord is saying on confession. Being open about the sins that the enemy uses to devil us. And there, number three, step number three is the step about repentance now. Now, you know what? We have accepted. We have confessed. Now, we repent. You know, repentance, it is not something that at least is a very smooth and a beautiful thing. Repentance is not, have you ever heard people who make a repentance very easy? You hear even somebody anaambiwa na unajua ulitukosea. And then somebody just come and say, by the way, kama niliwakosea, munisamehe. And those are the things that we hear all every day. You even hear people when they have done a mistake. I have heard stories of men who, when they have a lango and have a problem with their wives, when they go out there in town, they go and buy what the wives are alive, and they come with it. And then when they come with a chocolate, or maybe they come with a kilo of meat, they believe that they have told the wife sorry. But you know, when it comes to God, it is not playing games. When we come to God, we must be specific. But now, when we are talking about specificity, let me read a verse in the book of Acts chapter 3. Acts chapter 3 and verses 19. The book of Acts chapter 3 and verses 19. This is what the Bible says. The Bible tells us that now repent of your sin and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped away. Now, when we talk about repentance, four things happen. Number one, repentance is mentioning that sin before God. But having said that, it is important to talk about sincere repentance. When you mention it to God, then you must have the attitude and the willingness to turn away from that sin. You know, there is one thing to repent, but not willing to turn away. There are people who have gone to repent of their sins, but inside them, they still have the desire to continue doing it. But now I want to cleanse myself. But they have not made a decision that I have sinned, but I'm breaking this habit. I'm breaking this relationship, and I'm not going to pick it anymore. I have sinned, but I'm not going to go back in that business. I have sinned, but I'm not going to back to that kind of a friendship, because it has cost me to sin before God. In other words, number two, it is turning away. But also number three, it is turning towards God. You know, you can turn away from sin and then you just live a neutral life. By the way, number three is like when you turn away from sin, you also make a decision to pursue God. In other words, to pursue righteousness. If I was lying, I pursue talking the truth even when it hurts. When I stop stealing, I may continue to do just work even when I'm not getting big profit. When I have stopped doing any manner of evil, it's like I turn and I start doing the work of righteousness. And now, and finally, number four, it is restoration. Because it says, after that, your sins may be wiped away. In other words, we find God's restoration. And brethren, this morning and this day, what we desire more than anything, that by God's grace, we may be able to find the true repentance, sincere repentance, that helps us to be able to recognize our sins, to repent of that sins, and we turn away from the sins. We are able to turn to God, and we are cleansed, or we are restored of all our sins. Allow me to the parting shot. After we have done that, there is also something that the devil uses as a legal ground. And this is in the book of, you remember the Lord's Prayer, Jesus saying that if you don't forgive other people's sin, your sins will not be forgiven. And you know that the devil uses as a legal ground that when we don't forgive others, we are not forgiven. After we have done that and repentance, I want to ask you, brethren, may this be the attitude that we stand before God. Let us accept to forgive others. We forgive the people who have sinned against us. We forgive the people who have been unfaithful to us. We forgive for people who broke our trust. Those people who we were so loyal to, but they betrayed us. Let us pursue to forgive men and women who have hurt us. They hurt our marriages. They hurt our businesses. They were business partners. They stole from us. And they lost us wallowing in poverty where they continue to excel. And every time when you see them, you feel pain and bitterness. This morning, because we are coming before God's presence to seek that he may forgive, this is the standard. We must also accept that we may be able to forgive others. And that's what James said, that confess your sins to one another. Confess your sins to one another, that we may be able to find healing, that we may also go in to find God's righteousness, that our prayers may be effective, so that the enemy may not hold a legal ground against our repentance, that we may not find forgiveness of our sins. Let us let every other person go and let God in his grace and in forgiveness, that we may find healing. Father, we thank you so much because you are the source of our forgiveness. Because with your sacrifice at the cross, you declared our forgiveness by saying it is finished. The work of redemption, the work of atonement was completed. But Lord Jesus, we come this day to repent of many of our sins, our wickedness that we have done before you. The things that we have done before you. We pray that you help us as we open them before you and not considering them. Hear us. As we make an attitude to return to you and turn away from our sins, we pray that we may find the cleansing of our sight. Restore us with righteousness and give us the grace to forgive men and women who have sinned against us, who have hurt and wounded us, that we may be able to find effectiveness even in our prayer. And hear our prayer, O God. Hear our repentance and forgive our sins. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. May the Lord bless you. Have a blessed and a repentant day ahead.